Hello and welcome to the class of Constitution of India for Engineers. This is a unique and novel subject which has been brought into the syllabus of engineering students so that they can understand what is the relevance of Constitution of India for engineers. In fact, Constitution of India is not only relevant for engineers, it's relevant for every citizen of India. And any person who wants to come here and do any kind of activity here, even if you go outside, then Constitution of India travels with you even outside India. So let us begin the document, the most pious document in the history of India, that's called as Constitution of India. Let us begin. What we are going to discuss in this topic today is introduction to the Constitution of India. Then we'll see the making of our Constitution and thereafter salient features of our Constitution. These three topics are the subject matter of unit number 1. Let us begin one by one. Introduction. The Constitution was passed by a Constituent Assembly on 26th of November 1949 and it is fully applicable since January 26, 1950. Now, every one of us know that 26 January 1950 is our Republic Day and 26th November 1949 falls after 15th of August 1947. So, 26th November 1949, it means our constitution was not there on the day of independence, that is 15th of August 1949. It came into existence thereafter and it was adopted by us on 26th of November 1949 and it was promulgated, adopted by Indian people on 26th of January 1950. So, this was passed by the Constituent Assembly. So, we will have to discuss what is the meaning of the term Constituent Assembly and what was the composition of the Constituent Assembly. So, Constituent Assembly, we are going to discuss it a little later. There are many people who were drawn from the freedom struggle of India and who were part of this Constitution Drafting Committee, Constitution Assembly. And now let us begin why and how the Constituent Assembly took its job. The Constituent Assembly was elected for undivided India. Mind the word, undivided India. Before 14th of August 1947, there was nothing like Pakistan. There was only one country which was called as India. In fact, the freedom movement which was started by Gandhiji and other people was for undivided India. So this Constituent Assembly was elected for undivided India and held its first sitting on 9th of December 1946. Reassembled on 14th of August 1947, mind it, this is the day of independence of Pakistan and 15th of August 1947 is the day of independence of India. So this Constituent Assembly was elected for undivided India. First thing, it means it came into existence before 14th of August 1947. And then it held its first sitting on 9th of December 1946. Reassembled on 14th of August 1947 as the Sovereign Constitution Assembly for the Dominion of India. We'll have to understand the term Dominion of India and what is the meaning of Sovereign Constituent Assembly. The meaning of the term Sovereign Constituent Assembly is India being a sovereign country, its people are the destiny makers of India. Therefore, we being a sovereign country, our constituent assembly was also a sovereign constituent assembly which was entrusted with the job of drafting the constitution of India. This is a sample photograph of many members of the constituent assembly, and these gentlemen who are and women who are also called as forefathers of our country, founders of our constitution. So what was the composition of constituent assembly? How it was elected? See, 292 members by provincial legislative assembly, distributed among the three main communities, Muslims, Sikhs and general, in proportion to their population. Now you will ask, what is the meaning of the term provincial legislative assembly? Before independence, there were some provinces of India who were declared as provincial assemblies, and they were having their elected members. So these provincial assemblies were given the job of electing their representatives to the Constituent Assembly of India, and there were three main communities residing in India back then: Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs, and then other people were categorized as general category people. Then Indian princely states were allotted a minimum of 93 seats along with the provincial state for which members were being elected by the Indian people. There were princely states also, like the princely state of Hyderabad, princely state of Jammu and Kashmir. There were many princely states which were in existence back then. They were allotted 93 seats to 292 members and 93 members. Then unfortunate event happened. Due to the partition plan of June 3, 1947, this was a tragic event in the history of India. The territories which fell under Pakistan and those members who were part of Constituent Assembly and they were belonging to Pakistan, they ceased to be member of Constituent Assembly which was entrusted with the job of drafting the Constitution for Sovereign Republic of India. Therefore, the membership Constituent Assembly was reduced to 299 in total. These 299 people from Indian provinces, including people elected from princely states, 299 of them, 284 were actually present on 26 November 1949 and appended their signatures on the constitution. Then it was finally passed. Now, what were the stages in the development of the constitution? Our constitution came into existence in a number of stages. We Indians, our forefathers, had to struggle a lot to bring this independence to us. So to understand how our constitution progressed into existence, first of all, there was a Government of India Act 1935. The struggle of Indian independence ensured that India should be governed by its own act. So British Parliament passed this act, Government of India Act 1935, which became later on the backbone of Indian Constitution. This backbone of Indian Constitution, Government of India Act, described federation and provincial autonomy. Federation means collection of states, and within that federation there are several states which are autonomous in their own right, meaning thereby even today we can see that there is a central government, there are state governments, there are certain matters for which state government can take decisions. Even in the time of Corona, you can see the guidelines which was issued by the central government just day before yesterday say that the red zone, green zone and orange zone will be decided by the state government, and then the state government will take the decision whether inter-state buses or intra-state buses will be allowed to be run or not. So there is an autonomy given to the various states under the union, and these states collectively are called federation. Then a bicameral central legislature was created by this Government of India Act, which today we call Act Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Then this Government of India Act also provided the basis of distribution of powers between the center and provinces. Even today we see our constitution, which was adopted in 1950, also provides a fair distribution of matters which are within the domain of central government, a fair distribution of matters which is under the domain of the state governments, like defense, communication, foreign relation, are within the domain of the central government. State law and order, like in Delhi, is still in hands of central government, but state law and order, like in Uttar Pradesh, is in the hands of elected government of Uttar Pradesh. So the basis of this division in power was provided in the Government of India Act back in 1935 itself. So then after Government of India Act 1935, it came into existence, but it failed to fulfill the aspirations of Indian people, because Indian people wanted complete freedom. So a demand for a proper constituent assembly was made so that we Indians can draft our own regulation. First of all, in 1938, Pandit Nehru formulated the demand for constituent assembly, that we Indians should be allowed to form a constituent assembly of our own. Then Cripps Mission in 1942 recognized the demand for the constitution framed by elected constituent assembly of Indians. Just see the difference in timing. This demand was made in 1938. 4 years down the line, Cripps Mission recognized this demand for the first time. But here was a catch. The catch was, please read this line, India to be given a dominion status. This was the matter which was not acceptable to leaders of Indian freedom movement. Kipps' proposal was rejected by Gandhiji, who started Quit India movement in 1942. Immediately thereafter, Quit India movement was started by Gandhiji. Then in 1946, Cabinet Mission came from England. Formation of Constituent Assembly took after the initiatives of Cabinet Mission in 1946. Just see. Mr. Stafford Cripps, his name was Stafford Cripps, he came to India with a definite plan that, okay, you demand a constituent assembly, we are ready to give you a constituent assembly. You can draft your own constitution. However, and what was this however? This however was India to be given a dominion status. Now please understand what is the meaning of the term dominion status. When India was being governed by our British rulers, the British Queen was the head of the state for India also. British monarch was used to be the king, and India was part of the kingdom. India was a colony of British Raj. The then English Prime Minister, whose name was Mr. Winston Churchill, if you remember, he once described Gandhiji as a half-naked fakir, and also he was so disdainful of the idea of Indian independence, that he once famously said, that why are you giving independence to these Indians? Can they govern themselves? Can they elect their representatives? They cannot. He was so disdainful of the capacity of the Indians. So he was just buying time. And in 1942, Second World War was there. British people wanted Indian cooperation in the Second World War. Gandhiji agreed, but then Gandhiji bargained that we must get full freedom. And in 1942, this Stafford Cripps cheated Indians. What he promised, India to be given a dominion status, it means India will be given a certain kind of autonomy. You can elect your representative as you are electing under the Government of India Act 1935. You can elect your representative. However, you will continue to be a British colony. It means the British Queen will continue to be your head of the state. This was the meaning of the term dominion status, that England will continue to dominate you. And this was not acceptable to the leaders of our freedom movement. Gandhiji rejected it, and he started immediately thereafter, he started Quit India movement in 1942. 4 years down the line, cabinet mission came into India, 1946. And he recognized that, okay, you will be given a constitution drafting committee, which will be called as Constituent Assembly. And then Stafford Cripps mission failed, cabinet mission succeeded, and thereafter a joint constitution assembly for India and Pakistan. Back then, joint constitution assembly for India and Pakistan was constituted. The first meeting was held also on December 9, 1946, as we have seen earlier. However, it was backed by the Muslim League. Muhammad Ali Jinnah was the leader of Muslim League, and he boycotted it because he wanted a separate assembly for Pakistan. His demand was that there should be a separate constituent assembly for Pakistan, because he wanted a partition plan to be executed in totality. In the meeting with Lord Mountbatten and other people, Jinnah rejected this idea of constituent assembly for unified India. He demanded that separate constituent assembly for India and separate constituent assembly for Pakistan should be constituted. So Mountbatten agreed to it. Mountbatten's plan was Indian Independence Act 1947, minded before constitution. We have referred two acts. One was Government of India Act 1935, and the other is Indian Independence Act 1947. What they said? On 26 July 1947, Governor General Lord Mountbatten announced the setting up of a separate constituent assembly for Pakistan. Okay, so on 26 July 1947, it was crystal clear that now India is going to be divided into two countries. It was a tragic decision. No doubt it was a tragic decision. But this is the fact mentioned in the history of India. So Mountbatten's plan was to ensure peace, normality, tranquility. But we know, as a student of history, each plan went haywire. Constituent Assembly of India. On 14th August 1947, Sovereign Constituent Assembly for India was reassembled. You see, on next day, we got our independence. One day before, our Sovereign Constituent Assembly for India was reassembled, and it started drafting Constitution of India. Dr. Rajendra Prasad, our first president, was elected as the president of the Constituent Assembly of India. 7-member drafting committee was formed, and Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar acted as chairman of the drafting committee. It means The Constituent Assembly was presided over by Dr. Rajendra Prasad ji. However, the work of drafting the various articles of the Constitution was undertaken by a committee headed by Dr. B. R. Ambedkar. So, the actual drafting was undertaken by the drafting committee headed by Dr. B. R. Ambedkar, and then its draft were discussed in the whole meeting of the Constituent Assembly. It received the assent of the President of the Constituent Assembly Committee, and then it was adopted. It took 2 years, 11 months, 18 days in framing the Constitution, and then this Constitution was adopted on 26th of November 1949. Here is the preamble, the very famous preamble of the Constitution of India. This is the most beautiful part of the Constitution of India. Preamble, Prastavana. Preamble means the very solemn promise which the Indian people made with themselves. This is the beauty of the Constitution, that this promise is made by Indian people with themselves, and they adopted the Constitution. Indian people gave this Constitution to themselves. It means it is a promise made by every Indian to every other Indian. And this promise is so solemn, so pavitra, so solemn that it resides in our heart. Thank you very much. We'll deliver the rest in our next lecture. Thank you.